It's another great day in the AK. Do it our way, the 8-star way. Drive a car anywhere you wanna go. Up there, all around.
Yeah! What's up, brother?
Intuitive females are now becoming psychic females.
All these fucking people in this country, if you don't let this country fuck up.
Intuitive males are now becoming the god they were supposed to be. A god is only a person with more powers than the average person around them in a humanoid fleshly body. But the mind has been altered. The spirit and the soul are vibrating high.
Magic, and yourself, the most important one of all. Believe it.
It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? It's a neighborly day in this beauty wood, a neighborly day for a beauty.
Jankum is where somebody poops in a jar, seals it up, lets it marinate, and then comes back to get high off of it later.
How can we help foster the public-private partnerships, bringing American capital and expertise and standards to Africa so that we can keep exploiting, so that we can exploring where we can get these minerals?
You are not going to get anywhere in this world. You're not going to get anywhere financially, spiritually, socially, or otherwise until you get to that point where you don't give a damn about what other people think about you.
A wise person once said, "My life got better when I realized I didn't have to be nice. Nice got me used, stressed out, and disrespected. I'm not nice, I'm a good person. There's a difference. You don't have to be nice to be a good person. Being good means being honest, setting boundaries, and taking care of yourself without compromising your values. Being nice may give you temporary approval, but it rarely earns you respect or helps you build genuine connection. Honor your truth. You won't regret it."
I'm happy because I'm fulfilling my purpose of life. See, everything was created for purpose. Trees have a purpose. The moon has a purpose. Rats have a purpose. Insects, everything God created has a purpose. That's another one of my lectures entitled "The Purpose of Life." And the wise man is he who knows his life purpose. See, 10 men with the knowledge of their purpose are more powerful than 1,000 men working from morning until evening and who don't know their purpose.
So you watched the Hunger Games and you sided with the Resistance. You watched Star Wars and you sided with the Resistance. You watched The Matrix and you understood and sided with the Resistance. You watched the movie Divergent and you sided with the Resistance. You watched V for Vendetta and you cheered on the Resistance. When it's fiction, you understand and you side with the Resistance. Yet when it's happening to you in real life, right now, in the news, in the world, right now, you refuse to see it. When it's the reality that you are living in, you're afraid to resist in real life. Phew, blows my mind.
This is one reason why they eliminated Prodigy, Mobb Deep. Listen closely.
They have major programs, immunization programs, where they're poisoning us, you know? They're infecting us with stuff on purpose, and it's called population control. They have these programs they do in Africa, where they immunize the whole village. They'll give them shots, mm-hmm. And it's poison. They're killing them. They're giving them disease. They're filling them up with mercury.
A devastating discovery has been made in Canada. The remains of 215 children have been found buried at the site of a former boarding school for Indigenous students. The school in British Columbia was part of a nationwide scheme that took in First Nations children in an effort to assimilate them into Canadian society. Investigations have shown there was widespread abuse.
In mid-October of 1964, kissing cousins Elizabeth and Philip paid a royal visit to a Catholic residential school for Aboriginal children in Kamloops, British Columbia, Canada. William Coombs was 12 years old at the time of the royal visit. "I was an inmate at the Kamloops school when we were visited," said Coombs. "I remember it was strange because they came by themselves, no big fanfare or nothing. But I recognized them, and the school principal told us it was the Queen. And we all got given new clothes and good food for the first time in months the day before she arrived."
Really important. Pizza parties with pop stars often?
No.
Okay.
I eat children. How old are you?
12.
Oh, okay. Only to 10.
Only
okay,
to
that's
10.
Good.
Her parties are incredible at her house, too.
Yeah. She does have good parties, and she makes good pizza as well.
She makes great pizza, yes.
Wonderful pizza.
We've had pizza. Girl after my own heart, do we love a pizza or what? We love
a
pizza.
We do.
It's so much fun.
I can't take it.
A lot of people are going to say I'm psycho or something like that, but there really is a definite plan to turn this world into a one-world communist government. It's proven, and I believe it was in 67, that Khrushchev said that they would destroy our country and they wouldn't fire a shot doing it.
Venezuela, by the way, has the lowest murder rate ever right now. What does that tell you?
Yeah, all the murderers are gone.
They're here.
Yeah. So is it true that they're emptying prisons? I mean, is this is not, Cuba this is, all over again?
This is not a hearsay. There was a memo by DHS last year admitting that, in fact, they knew that Venezuela's government was emptying their prison and rehabilitation centers or drug centers, releasing them on purpose because they knew with instructions to make, if you were going to get out, you're going to make your way to the U.S. That is not, we're not making that up. That's true. It was reported on, and DHS admitted that that was happening. And in fact, it has. El Tren de Aragua is heavily present in our country now.
Okay, so you're telling me that DHS has acknowledged that Venezuela, for example, is emptying their prisons and their rehabilitation centers with the understanding you get out if you leave here and go to the United States?
Yes.
And DHS has in writing said, we know that's happening. We know they're coming here. We're processing them in and have no idea where they are.
Correct.
How many people are we talking about?
Millions. In just Venezuela alone.
We're talking about in the last 2 or 3 years, we've had estimated how many people have come across the border.
My estimation, the official number, I think, is about to hit 10 million.
Yeah, it's about 10, 11 million. Yeah, that's the official.
But my personal opinion, I think we're about 15 to 18 million.
Working on rats and electrodes, and putting electrodes in their brain. And I was slated to go up to Toronto to work with the guru of brain-machine interfaces. But as I did more research into the problem, I found that this dream of being able to give people robotic arms or legs, I don't think will ever happen. And that's because the brain knows that these small electrodes that listen to the brain are not part of the body, so it rejects it, builds up a wall of scar, and then the electrodes that can't hear the neurons, the little tiny cells in the brain that send the signals. So the goal that I wanted to accomplish, which was to become a neurosurgeon who specializes and does research on brain-machine interface work, I thought that that would not work out in the end because of those limitations.
They're hiding the true answer to this question from us. How is it that people who used horses and buggies constructed gigantic, intricate buildings like these? They allegedly only used hammers, manual saws, and basic tools. Does that make any sense to you? Look at these grand structures and ask yourself, how could they achieve all this with such primitive methods? It makes you wonder if our historical timeline is accurate or completely fabricated to hide something. It gets even scarier. What if the dates on these buildings are wrong? Imagine if that number one wasn't a one at all. Our history could be off by 1,000 years. This brings us to who could have built these intricate structures. Have you ever heard of Tartaria? Tartaria is a colossal empire that conveniently gets left out of mainstream history. But you can never truly erase history, as many references can be found in old maps and documents. Tartaria was a highly advanced civilization with technology and knowledge far beyond what we can imagine. They have even been credited to have built the Great Wall of China and many of these intricate buildings pictured earlier. Could Tartaria be the missing link that explains these architectural marvels and historical anomalies? The Grand Canyon is not just an American sightseeing location. There are strange and dark secrets that lie within. Some have even encountered a gateway to a hidden world. In 1909, the Arizona Gazette published an article about an expedition funded by the Smithsonian. This expedition was led by a man named G.E. Kincaid, and he discovered an ancient underground city within the Grand Canyon. But here is where it gets interesting. This city was filled with artifacts from ancient Egypt, hieroglyphs, statues, and even a pyramid. How did ancient Egyptian relics end up in Arizona over 5,000 years ago? Is it possible that they had access to flight? But it gets even stranger. The Smithsonian seized all the artifacts and shut down any further exploration, which led to 90% of the Grand Canyon being restricted till this day. The canyon is home to numerous hidden caves and tunnels, many holding ancient treasures and technologies. Many adventurers used to report seeing strange lights and sounds coming from these depths. The Hopi tribe, a tribe native to the region, speak of sacred underground cities known as the Sipapu. These cities are believed to be gateways to the underworld, holding powerful energies that should never be disturbed. All this makes us wonder, what else is hiding in the Grand Canyon?
They whitewash the skies, they call it vanilla skies.
They'll blotch out the sky and cut away from what they want to leave in the photo. They can cut away what was there and replace it with a gray or white vanilla colored sky.
Vanilla sky, where the background is cut out and you can see the crop marks, you can zoom in and see where the edge of the building just, there's a little bit of a blurry edge. The sky that would have been the background has been disappeared. It's like, well, why would they do that? If you see one construction photo that's off, where they've painted in scaffolding, or they've taken out backgrounds, you have to stop. Why did they go to the extent to do this? You have to ask the question. And if you see hundreds of photos that are done this way, you have to realize this was an industrial scale effort to create a narrative.
Hi, look, here, we're in Ross. Look how cute, huh?
I just don't have the capacity to tiptoe around people's triggers.
What'd you say?
I just want to be in healthy.
You got to go back and say that part again. You said you don't have the capacity to do what?
To tiptoe around people's triggers. Because if you're constantly triggered just by my presence, by my typical conversation, if this is just who I am, then that's okay. We just might not are supposed to be friends in this capacity because we have differing personality types. Mm-hmm. And that's why I think like the sisterhood thing is great in theory. Yeah. But if it's the A, B, C, and D personality, and B and D clash, like A and B get along, B and C get along, C and D get along, but there's going to be some clash when there's so many different personality types.
Why the ancients really put earrings in their ears?
In the ear, when you have your ear like that, in Chinese medicine, you imagine the ear like this to be like an inverted fetus with the eyes here, the hands here, you see, and the legs here. It's like that. And the points here in treatment, they reflect every organ in your body. So your whole body is present in your ear like that. Now, in ancient times, there's nothing called jewelry. You wear jewelry here, you wear jewelry there. No. At the time when the door was open, you used things on your body for certain interactions with the forces of nature. So this point here in Chinese acupuncture is called the point of inner light. And if you put some crystals or diamonds here, that means you activate through resonance, you enter into resonance with your inner light. So your inner vision gets activated. And when they had the priestesses, the young priestesses in the temples, one of the way to activate their inner vision was to put any type of crystal or diamond here, depending on what you want to do, you see. Today, you find people piercing everywhere. Now, that's very, very dangerous. You could completely disrupt the functioning of your physical organ.
Yo, check this out. You hear that? That's static electricity when I reach my hand out over the edge. Wish I could shoot lightning bolts out of my fingers. This is wild. Crazy being up on the top of a mountain in a thunderstorm. But check out that view down there. That is awesome. Absolutely beautiful out here. And the rain is kind of going sideways and up. Look at the hand. Ooh, man, that just shocked me. Ouch. Probably not safe to be up here, but here we are. I paid 20 bucks to get in. I'm going to get my money's worth. Look at the hair on my arm. It's standing up. But I'm not gonna risk it too much. I think we'll call it good there.
Every day I wake up and wanna go back to bed. No matter how much I've slept, I wanna go back to bed. No matter what I'm doing, I know what I wanna be doing instead. I wanna go back to bed. I wanna go back to bed.
Started to cry, but then remembered I can buy myself flowers.
In my Roman Empire is remembering that one guy that sued the Pepsi company because he found a mouse in his Mountain Dew, and he lost the case because Pepsi was able to prove that a mouse would completely dissolve in a can of Mountain Dew within a couple days, and it takes more than a couple days for the cans to get out of the factory.
If you killed 60,000 people with your company, your company makes peanut butter, and that peanut butter killed 60,000 people, they'd be like, you gotta stop making peanut butter. But with the drug companies, they're like, oh, your experimental drug where you lied about all the tests killed 60,000 people? Well, we're gonna need a small portion of the money that you made as a fine. like Vioxx. Vioxx made somewhere around $12 billion. It killed somewhere between 50 and 60,000 people, and they had to pay somewhere in the range of $5 billion in fines. That's wild.
Yes.
Because that means you are allowed to profit $7 billion and kill 50,000 plus people.
I love Venn diagrams. I really do. I love Venn diagrams. It's just something about those three circles and the analysis about where there is the intersection, right? Yeah, I see people. You agree, right? So I asked my team. I brought props.
What do people your age think about it, about feminism?
They don't think that it's a conspiracy being, you know, like an anti-natalist,
right, so
satanic conspiracy.
They're
no, I think you might have a little something going on. But I think that's...
Listen,
whoa,
right?
Hold on.
You got to qualify that statement a little bit.
She's calling me crazy, even though it's well documented that Gloria Steinem was a CIA agent. I back you up, girl.
I think you have a little conspiracy-minded thing going on where you're looking for a conspiracy and everything.
No, I just am informed and educated, and I'm not arrogant enough to assume that my ignorance means that somebody else is crazy.
But I mean, I can also say I'm informed and educated, and I, you know, like, we can go back and forth saying that forever.
Well, so do you know then that what she's saying about Gloria Steinem is not only correct, but that through the Congress for Cultural Freedom in the 60s and 70s, the CIA was pushing feminism through like 40 different publications around the world. They sent, you know, people to
festivals. So what if Gloria Steinem was like a CIA operative? Gloria Steinem's not the only feminist in the world.
No, I'm saying it's not just her. I'm saying the Congress for Cultural Freedom, which was a widespread CIA program that went around the world in dozens of countries and had hundreds of magazines, newspaper outlets, all pushing feminism. This was not just like one lady. This was like a broad effort during the Cold War to kind of differentiate Western liberal values from Russia. So they pushed feminism and the sexual revolution.
I mean, are you anti like classical liberalism and Western liberal values?
Yes, I absolutely am.
Okay,
yeah.
But you're also anti.
Yo, this adds a whole new layer to our reparations claim. This government didn't just steal from us through enslavement and by confiscating over 12 million acres of land in the 1900s, which would account to the theft of over 90% of our land, but they also stole over $600 billion through unfair taxes right after slavery. So starting in the late 19th century and early 20th century, this is what they would do. They would artificially inflate our property tax value estimates and subsequently overcharge us. And because we couldn't pay those exorbitant taxes, they then come in and systemically steal our land. For example, Anthony Fleming and J.R. Rooks were two black men who were forced off their farmland by white supremacist mobs. They then went on to establish a town with the goal of enabling black Americans to own land. This is after they were already forced off their land by a white supremacist mob. By 1911, this town, Edmondson, Arkansas, encompassed 30 square miles of stores, a bank, a hotel, and a post office for local black homeowners. Then, 20 years later, this town was no more after white plantation owners plotted to seize land by imposing taxes on lots that Edmondson residents were unaware of. These black folks who owned this property had no idea about these taxes, and then because they didn't pay them, their land was taken. These plantation owners who stole the land.
Are you still in despair about the world?
I never have been in despair about the world. I'm in rage.
Enraged, all right.
But I don't think I'm in despair. I can't afford despair. I can't tell my nephew, my niece. You can't tell the children. There's no hope. I take my cue from Christ, really, who told me and told all of us to love each other, clothe the naked, feed the hungry. And if you can't do that, you're not a believer. Mm. I don't care what church you go to.
Here we have a group of white women, Basicus White Womenicus, painting out the next neighborhood they will gentrify.
This is where we'll put the Lululemon. Coffee shop right here, and then we're gonna do a yoga studio right here. Oh my god, she's a genius.
I'm sorry, what now?
He did what to a child and he's allowed to compete at the Olympics? Let me see if I have this white. Shikari was not able to compete in the Olympics because she consumed a plant that did not enhance her performance and was perfectly legal in her place of residence. But this individual can rape a 12-year-old girl. He traveled just to do it. Is convicted and served jail time, and he's allowed to continue to compete in the Olympics. And before anyone comes at me and says that this isn't allowed by the Olympics, there is a morality clause in every sports federation that he is actively violating, but they are choosing not to enforce. It's almost like certain individuals just get to freely commit certain crimes and face little to no consequences because the people that are upholding that system are just like them. The resemblance is stunning, isn't it? And just like Brock Turner, he only served a fraction of his sentence. Not only is this a slap in the face to his victim, but all of the female Olympians that have to be around this individual. There are minor girls that are competing in the Olympics and they have to be in the Olympic Village with a known child rapist. But you guys don't care about them, do you?
I don't know what most white people in this country feel. I can only include what they feel from the state of their institutions. I don't know if white Christians hate Negroes or not, but I know that we have a Christian church which is white and a Christian church which is black. I know, as Malcolm X once put it, that the most segregated hour in American life is high noon on Sunday. That says a great deal for me about a Christian nation. It means that I can't afford to trust most white Christians and certainly cannot trust the Christian church. I don't know whether the labor unions and their bosses really hate me. That doesn't matter, but I know I'm not in their unions. I don't know if the real estate lobby is anything against black people, but I know the real estate lobbies keep me in the ghetto. I don't know if the Board of Education hates black people, but I know the textbooks they give my children to read and the schools that we have to go to. Now, this is the evidence. You want me to make an act of faith, risking myself, my wife, my woman, my sister, my children, on some idealism which you assure me exists in America, which I have never seen.
That's real. Listen, man, when we start cleaning up our communities, multi-billion-dollar, trillion-dollar companies is going to lose money. Right? And they feed their families off of us killing each other. They send their children to school off of us killing each other. They live in mansions and drive on yachts off of us killing each other. The ambulance, the police officers, the pharmaceutical industry. When you get shot up and you got to take them perks and them pills, that's money. You see what I'm saying? That they losing when we stop killing each other. The ride to the ambulance, you get a hospital bill for that. They start losing money when we stop killing each other. You understand what I'm saying? The obituaries, the funeral homes, they start losing money. The lawyers that we paying millions of dollars to get us off this case, they start losing money when we stop killing each other. So you don't think it's somebody that's sitting in the back responsible for making sure that we keep killing each other so that they can keep eating? When you go to prison, each inmate, they make money, bro. Off of the inmates up in there. They make money off of our free labor in prison. Building stuff for them. You see what I'm saying? So you don't think it's people out here that's like, no, let me promote this rapper talking about sliding on the ops. Let me promote you trolling these brothers for somebody that you done killed. Because the more you incite them to murder and kill, the more we eat.
Now, is there something to worry about with medicines? That is, might some of them have side effects? Do we need safety testing? I mean, and we're taking things that are, you know, genetically modified organisms, and we're injecting them in little kids' arms. We just shoot them right into the vein.
I have no recollection. I'm sorry, would you repeat the question? What's the question again? I'm not sure. I don't recall anything from that phone call. You know, I don't recall your...
It is irrefutable that there is something attached to the bottom of this plane and a distinct flash as it makes contact. Let's take a look at this event from another angle. And now let's take a look at it again from a third angle. And now let's take a look at it one more time from a fourth angle. There can be no doubt that this is not the result of a reflection of any sort, but in fact was a flash caused by an explosion, a detonation, a missile, something happened.
But the pod shape turned out to be nothing more than a bulge called a wing fairing. Perfectly normal for a 767. And we certainly don't see any missile shooting out. What were those flashes all about?
I don't recall this. If you show me this now and ask me the question, do you recall this? I'd have to say I don't recall. You know, I don't recall. It's possible, but I don't recall. I'm not sure.
Meanwhile, Judy Wood was publishing articles bashing Stephen Jones, and with very good reason.
At that point in time, there was a falling out between Steve and me. I had invited Judy Wood onto the program. It was actually the last show I had with a radio broadcast on Republic. And we were talking about all the research she did in displaying the vast range of damage, not just to the Twin Towers, but to buildings 3, 4, 5, and 6. Where, of course, Building 7 didn't come down until 5:20 in the afternoon and requires a whole separate explanation.
I don't recall. I may have, but I don't recall. I don't specifically remember.
Do you recall that?
I don't recall it.
The massive degree of pulverization. Photographs of this dust cloud enveloping New York City that involve billions of cubic yards of very fine dust. It became apparent to me at that point in time that there was no possible way that an hypothesis rooted in conventional explosives, even supplemented by cutter charge like thermate and thermate, could possibly be adequate to explain all of the data. Now, Steve and I had a divergence here because I wanted to broaden the range of hypotheses for consideration, but Steve and some of his allies really basically wanted to restrict the focus to their preferred hypothesis.
Again, that's not something that rings a bell with me that I would remember. I don't recall ever, not to my knowledge, I don't know if they did. I don't recall specifically.
Entertainment purposes only. Look, when you hit the chemtrail switch early, let's watch. Ah, look, oh, it comes from the height, because of the crystals. What's this then, dude? Come on, what's this then? Yeah? You see, the truth is always going to come to the surface, mate. Chemtrail, okay? Back to the cockpit. Chemtrail menu on the screen. 1. Chemtrail menu on the screen. 2. More chemtrail switches. More chemtrail switches. Yeah? We getting all of this? You know what I mean? What's that? Amber stop. Okay, that's nothing to do with it. Sorry. Cockpit, that's nothing, sorry. You know, I'm doing this live, so as you can, you know, see. Off and on chemtrails. What I'm showing you is in the cockpit exists the switch. There are patents. And there's a plane popping off the ground, pumping out all of it because he pressed it early. I don't know what else or what more to say on this subject to get the debunkers on board. Entertainment purposes only, guys. You know the score.
So something very strange happened not too long ago in the Bay of San Francisco area. And if you didn't hear about it, that's because you weren't meant to. It was specifically kept secret. So geoengineering tests quietly launches salt crystals into the atmosphere above San Francisco. So on a decommissioned aircraft carrier, they connected a whole bunch of high-powered spraying machine devices and shot microscopic salt aerosol particles hundreds of feet into the air. But the experiment was intentionally kept under the radar to minimize public backlash. The test last week took place in Alameda, California, on the USS Hornet, which operates as a Smithsonian affiliate museum. It was the first cloud brightening experiment ever conducted in North America. I don't quite believe that, but okay, we'll go with that for now. And just the second in the world. Oh, sure. 4 years ago, researchers, Australia, blah, blah, blah. Now, this is very interesting because last I checked, many articles on mainstream news sources roast anyone who thinks that secret chemicals are being sprayed to modify the weather. Well, as long as the science is settled and we trust the science, then I guess everything should be all right.
Again, I don't recall. It may have occurred, but I don't recall. I don't recall him saying that. I don't specifically recall. But I don't recall. But I don't recall.
We'll be right back.
courage to prove and reveal the terrible truth that we are all being watched. He conducted a simple experiment on Google Maps and its traffic congestion feature. Simon Weckert achieved this by collecting a total of 99 phones from various friends and rental companies. He then put all these phones in a cart and walked along the roads of Germany, which had virtually no traffic. He noticed that despite the lack of actual traffic, his phone displayed signals of heavy traffic on the roads he was walking on. From this, Simon concluded that Google Maps calculates traffic volume based on the number of phones clustered in a certain area. His theory turned out to be correct, as all the cell phones were signaling heavy traffic on the empty road where Simon was carrying the phones. All this is a little scary, because God knows what information they can still collect about us. Do you still think that they are not hiding anything from us?
So you're now no longer are you necessarily keeping those private files in some file cabinet that's locked in the basement of the house. It's on your laptop, and it's then therefore up here in this cloud that exists above us, right? Mm-hmm. It's no longer in a physical place.
Lemon on the chain with the V cut.
Yeah.
So you know eels? We have no idea where they come from. Like, literally, we do not know how they reproduce. Right, so if you grab an eel from the river, it won't have any reproductive organs. That is a fact. And it's because eels go through four life stages. They start off as a little larvae. It's got these big boggly eyes. Then they go through a phase where they're like these little see-through eels. They're called elvers that can wriggle around and swim upstream. Then they turn into the giant, gross, slippery single mussel that we all know and love as an eel. And only then, when they are fully mature, do they swim back out to sea, at which point their stomach dissolves and their reproductive organs form. So scientists wanted to know where all of these eels were headed to. They tracked all larvae and demonstrated that they all came from one particular place in the ocean called the Sargasso Sea. It's like a sort of a garden of seaweed that's got these very great currents of water around it. And this is the only place that eels are ever born. No eel has ever, ever, ever been born in captivity.
Okay, but this is actually insane.
Last February in Minnesota, Governor Waltz signed a new bill to redefine sexual orientation under Minnesota state law.
And in this updated definition, they crossed out the section which says sexual orientation does not include a physical or sexual attachment to children by an adult. In other words, the new definition of sexual orientation includes a physical or sexual attraction to children by an adult, and cannot be discriminated under Minnesota state law. The person who introduced the amendment said in the committee hearings that this was modernizing the terminology to reflect a more contemporary understanding of sexual orientation and gender. And this went through multiple revisions as a piece of legislation before being signed by the governor, in which they explicitly crossed out the part excluding pedophilia. Still think they're not trying to normalize this stuff?
The elites of this world believe in something called karmic retribution, which means as long as they tell you what they're about to do, it's okay for them to do it.
In its reign of terror.
Gangway! Oh?
Up to see New York? We could all go with the bus company's special super sitter fare.
$9? This one's on me.
Let's hope Osama bin Laden doesn't know show tunes.
God, I hope I get it. I hope I get...
Wait and see!
Oh, you stupid!
Well, you're stupider!
No, you're...
people, and I'm out of here.
As to the origin of the present Jews in Palestine, he states that those Jews derived from Eastern Europe, and many, many of
notice
the Jews
how
that today live
the similarities,
in
yeah?
the reconstituted state of Israel come from Eastern Europe, are not descendants of the Judeans or the lost tribes of Israel, but rather descendants of the Khazars. Who are they?
Who are they?
They were a nation most people do not even know of. He writes, the so-called self-styled Jews in Eastern Europe in modern history cannot legitimately point to a single ancient ancestor who ever set even a foot on the soil of Palestine in the era of Bible history. Research also revealed that the so-called or self-styled Jews in Eastern Europe were never Semites, are not Semites, now, nor can they ever be regarded as Semites at any future time by any stretch of the imagination.
People here are called anti-Semitic. What is your response to that as an Israeli Jew?
Well, it's a trick. We always use it. When from Europe somebody is criticizing Israel, then we bring up the Holocaust. When in this country people are criticizing Israel, then they are anti-Semitic.
What secret mysterious power has been able for countless generations to keep the origin and the history of the Khazars and the Khazar kingdom out of the history textbooks? Did you ever learn about it at school? I never learned about it.
And they saw the surge in how we was going up in salaries, but what wasn't being talked about, and they let that be the narrative to come back and change the whole construction, what the CBA was. Mm. Because what the owners wanted to do was control a network of money and control it the way they wanted to, which is not even that. You don't even know the details of the contract, bro. You don't even know that. Every matter of fact, I'm going blank. I'm going to say 2015 back to, let's say, I'm just going to say 2000, just so you don't have a, you know what I mean? Every motherfucker that made or that was considered a max player had to pay 10% of his earnings back to the owner. He ain't gonna let no shit out like that. Now, where in the world would you work for somebody? Turn around and get a brand that he paying you back to him. You don't hear none of this. You don't hear none of the nuances. You don't hear how, when you do get that brand, how they turn you to the villain. Bro, I really believe that the league has a system in which they put out on villains in which they can go get the, they can go get a text from two. At the time I was in the league, a text was $100. 5 years within that, text was $500. Within 2 more years of that, a tech was $1,000. Today's tech is what? $5,000, I'm saying to you? This is where the league gets money back.
My dad's a vampire. My blood dad's a vampire. My blood mom's a werewolf. Meaning I wound up with both their powers, so.
The vast majority of Freemasons haven't got a clue what their organization's part of. Only the few do. These different secret societies like the Freemasons, the Knights of Malta, the Knights Templar, all these different ones, they feed the chosen few up into this other pyramid that I'll call the Illuminati pyramid, but these organizations don't like to give themselves names, because you try researching an organization that doesn't have a name, not easy, so you have to give it one. But Illuminati is one they do use, and it's at this level of the game where the real knowledge is and the real manipulation comes from. So even the vast majority of people in secret societies have no clue what it's all about. This is Albert Pike, infamous and famous Freemason in America, absolutely almost worshipped by the Freemasonic community in America. And he said this, fictions are necessary to the people.
My lords, gentlemen, this is the most painful occasion on which I shall ever be called upon to address you. My first and melancholy duty is to announce to you the death of my beloved mother, the Queen.
My lords, ladies and gentlemen, it is my most sorrowful duty to announce to you the death of my beloved mother, the Queen.
And I know how deeply you, the nation, and I think I may say the whole world, sympathize with me in the great loss that we have all sustained.
I know how deeply you, the entire nation, and I think I may say the whole world, sympathize with me in the irreparable loss we've all suffered.
This man is going to be humiliated beyond belief.
Yeah.
He will not believe it. He will not believe what's going to happen to him.
Yeah.
Beyond his worst nightmares, sell one more record.
This attorney I found, I mean, I interviewed several, and I picked the nastiest son of a bitch I could find. Once I make that phone call, this guy is just going to destroy everybody in sight. Any devious, nasty, cruel way that he can do it. And I've given him full authority to do that. It'll be a massacre if I don't get what I want.
If I go through with this, I win big time.
I will get everything I want, and they will be destroyed forever. They will be destroyed. June is going to lose Jordy. She will have no right to ever see him again.
Yeah.
That's a fact, Dave. That's what's
going to happen. Michael's
career will be over.
Does that help Jordy?
Michael's career will be over.
And does that help Jordy?
That's irrelevant to me.
بنصارحكم بكل صراحة الملاكمة الإيطالية هي تعرفني منذ زمان وأنا سنوات وسنوات نزور إيطاليا في مدينة أسيسي في القاعة تاع أسيسي وين نجي ندير تربصات مغلب تربصاتي كانت في إيطاليا وين حتى المدربين يعرفوني منذ كنت صغيرة في فريق الوطني وكنت نروح ندرب عندهم بحد ذاتها الملاكمة كانت تعرفني وين تعرفني مليح وديجا كنت ندير معها تربصات في القاعة تاعهم في إيطاليا في أسيسي استغلوا هذه الحملة الإعلامية ضدي باش يأثروا عليا ولكن أنا إن شاء الله نكون ضمن الهدف اللي راني هنا على جاله أنا نوجه رسالتي لكامل شعوب العالم أنهم يكونوا متمسكين بالمبادئ الأولمبية حسب الميثاق الأولمبي وابتعاد عن التنمر على جميع الرياضيين لأنه هذا الشيء أثر ويأثر كثير وكثير وقادر يدمر ناس حتى يقتل تفكير وذهن ناس ويفرق شعوب أنا بنت منذ صغاري وأنا طموحة هدفي أولمبياد أنا هنا من أجل حلمي إن شاء الله نستطيع من تحقيق حلمي والذهاب بأحسن نتيجة إلى بلدي
يتفيد أين؟
كان هذا gewoon niet.
Ja, natuurlijk wel. Je moet gewoon durven. Maar kijk, zelfs Rosling gaat over de bok.
Rosling, mogen wij straks misschien bij Engels bij je afkijken?
Kom toch.
Nou, wat denk je? Oké, kom. Dan gaan we, Jet.
What is going on in the grocery stores in America? I've never seen
Somebody
this before.
Somebody tell me what's going on at Coke. This is the third six-pack that I've gotten that does this. They're not carbonated, and they're flat.
Makes
like,
no sense.
If I wanted Pepsi, I would have bought Pepsi. What is happening?
There's something weird in this little jar.
Sauce should not do that.
No.
My radish was moving like that. Do you see that? What is that?
Seriously, what is going on?
First of all, I soaked this meat in the vinegar, and yes, it changed color. Like, it went from pink to brown. So I was like, okay, maybe it's just the vinegar that got in there. But why is this beef holographic?
Mm-hmm. Anybody ever seen an asparagus like this? Check this out. Fresh out the box. Look at this.
Now what that's the hell for happened sure.
to these guys? I have never seen an asparagus like that before.
Together.
Dog, so this used to be an apple. What the fuck is this?
That's not an apple I've ever seen before.
This was an apple. Stay Look weird. At the stem.
Here's why. Everything you learn in school is a lie.
1920 is when everything pretty much changed. They started changing every single thing. They started removing Listen certain closely. Parts of the history. They started rewriting the history. 1920s is about that time. Educational system started changing everything. Rockefeller educational system. So if you find books, you want to find books before 1920s. Because if you don't find books before 1920s, you're usually being told a bunch of nonsense. And you look at a lot of the free energy books too, and everything related to the ether, that's before 1920s. The ether was removed from the periodic table after 1908. Every book you look into talks about ether and terrestrial magnetism and all of these things. 1908, that was removed off the periodic table.
Wonder why.
And that was removed so that people would not believe in the ether. They would think it's woo-woo. They would think it's pseudoscience. Those are all terms of the Rockefeller educational system. Coming up with terms to debunk the truth and debunk what we were once connected to. Then when you get rid of ether, you get rid of everything related to the fifth element and the quantum. You get rid of all of that. And then you make up a whole new narrative.
And that's
and
why.
You remove all that so that when you can't explain something, you just say, I don't know what it is.
I am convinced that NASA has replaced our sun with their patented sun simulator. Now, I know this sounds wild, but stick with me because I have the evidence to back this up. Now, first of all, you can look up the US patent for the solar simulator on Google. Now, this document goes deep on exactly how the simulator works and essentially is placed in front of the sun. All right, now let me show you a video that I took the other day of the sun, and I want you to notice this reflection right here. Now, here's a close-up of what that reflection looks like. It looks pretty familiar, doesn't it? This honeycomb shape. Now, obviously, this isn't coming from my phone camera, so how is this reflecting off the sun? Now, here is what the sun looked like in 2018, and I'm not the only one who remembers the sun being this bright orange color, and now it's this white LED light. Here's a reflection up here. Certainly not the same reflection that I took with my phone. Perhaps this is why around the world, people have been reporting their sunflowers shunning the sunlight. Now, this is what the sun used to look like and how I remember it growing up, this bright orange light, and now it's this bright white LED light that's hard to look at and hard to be under. Now, this video is not to purport any fear. Once a critical mass is reached and enough people know what's been going on underneath our noses, we will be able to take down these parasites. Now, you're going to see in this video how LED lights give off electromagnetic frequencies, EMF radiation. This could be why everyone's tired.
Depression. Farmers were producing plenty of food, but no one could afford to buy it. So farmers started going out of business. Under the farm bill, Uncle Sam paid farmers not to grow so many crops. By keeping supply down, the bill kept prices steady for the farmers. But after World War II, things began to change. New farming chemicals led to bigger harvests, and new petroleum-fueled machines were created to keep up with the surge. Starvation was history, but the explosion of food into the marketplace overwhelmed the government's ability to manage supply and demand. In the 1970s, Secretary of Agriculture Earl Butz had a different idea. In a complete 180, the government abandoned small farmers in favor of large mega farms that could churn out as much food as possible. All we had to do was find someone to eat this avalanche of cheap, low-quality food. In just two generations, a nation racked by hunger ate its way into obesity, diabetes, and all sorts of other problems.
Just rolled into the Lexington Library in Lexington, Kentucky, and they are pushing it hard. This room is reserved for teens only. Teen Pride Hangout. Hang out with other LGBT teens in a safe space. We'll have books, crafts, and a pride closet available. Watch LGBT movies, learn about your history, or just hang out with others in the community. Heartstopper. He told you to stop, you effing prick. Boy meets boy, boys become friends, boys fall in love. Every librarian in here is still wearing a mask. Did something happen that I'm unaware of? Pride Month. I thought this was in June. So I'm just gonna put that back there. Everyone belongs, but do they? Oh my gosh, what even is that?
But nobody wants to say it, because if you say it, then you're Kanye and you're crazy and you're anti whatever that thing is. There are entities in major cities that have big old shining buildings. And in those buildings, they have a whole lot of celebrities. And those celebrities go and jump on couches and make all types of deals, and nobody says anything. You know how, like, we'll hear people on the right and people on the left say, well, you know, the crime is so bad because of the rappers. But nobody seems to pay attention to the fact that the record label owners, the record label execs, the distributors, all happen to look a certain way, believe a certain way. Well, it's the Wizard of Oz all over again. Pay no attention to the man behind the curtain. Leo Cohen got on my friend Charlamagne's show and said, well, you know, I gotta eat. You've never starved a day in your life, Leo, and we all know why. But nobody wants to say it, because if you say it, then you're Kanye and you're crazy and you're anti whatever that thing is.
You know what I've noticed about women's fantasies, like when it comes to romance? Their ideal sense of romance is literally just cheating.
You know, the funny thing is, I didn't think this was true. I was like, man, he's just cherry picking examples. And then I did some research and he is 100% correct. Like, think about all the most popular romance movies ever. Sleepless in Seattle. Cheating. You've Got Mail. Cheating. 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 Cheating and some underage bullshit. International cheating. Oh my God, so much cheating. Cheating, but with good music. Cheating, but with comedy. Rich people cheating. Cheating down under. Old people cheating, and cheating plus music. Like, it is undeniably true. Every fucking successful romantic movie in, like, the last four decades has just had cheating. That's the women's fantasy.
How does someone become a narcissist? You know, the big question is, are they born that way? And the answer to that is no. Narcissism is like any personality style. It's shaped over the course of our childhood. Oh, there's sort of two pathways to becoming narcissistic. One of them is what I'm going to call the pathway of adversity. It's kids who are exposed to chaos, trauma, invalidation, problems with attachment in childhood. They might have been exposed to domestic abuse. They might have been exposed to really, really distracted, disinterested sorts of parents, very immature parents. That's one pathway that can lead to the development of narcissism in adulthood. Now, the piece I'm always going to say, the vast majority of children raised under those circumstances do not become narcissistic. The other way narcissism can be developed is by sort of overindulging a child, telling a child, you're more special than any other child. There is no other child like you. The other children don't matter as much as you. That sort of overspecialing a child, that's another pathway to narcissism. That tends to lead to more of a grandiose narcissistic style. Now, not every child raised that way becomes narcissistic either. A significant subset of those folks who are told you're so great, you're more special than anyone else, actually grow into a bit of imposter syndrome, failure to launch. They know darn well they cannot live up to all the specialness they told they had. And a parent who's always telling a child, you're more special than any other child, you shouldn't have to wait for things like any other child, is likely to be a narcissistic, or at least a narcissistic adjacent parent, right? So those are the pathways. And here's where it gets tricky. When you know the backstory on how someone becomes narcissistic, it's easier to make excuses for them. But that's not a justification, because again, the vast majority of people who grow up in either of these pathways don't go on to become narcissistic. And because we also know narcissistic people are able to sort of turn it on and off depending on them needing supply. They can be charming at the dinner party and terrible to you. They know how to turn it on and off. So they could make the choice to be kind to you. They just choose not to.
She's not a Christian!
She could be a Jew and believe in God.
It doesn't matter. She's tampering in dark sided stuff.
Y'all need to listen very closely on what he just said.
I'm going to go to South Korea where you get the chip booth. What are you doing?
Let me play that again and watch his eyes again. Listen very closely if you didn't hear it.
I'm going to go to South Korea where you get the chip booth. What are you doing? I'm going to get Japan and Korea back together again after.
So that's a little alarming to me, especially with how wide his eyes were and when he goes, what are you doing? And he changed to another subject.
My skin is black.
That's Nina Simone singing right there.
Y'all heard that song get sampled by Jay-Z in the story of OJ. But you know that Nina Simone's daughter and granddaughter and family did not get the royalties to that. Neither did they have any say-so in Nina Simone's documentary in her movie, because Kamala Harris, in 2013, do you know that she took Nina Simone's estate from her daughter, from her granddaughter? Yeah, the same Kamala Harris that we all see running on the sister girl this, sister girl that. In 2013, she charged Nina Simone's daughter with improper use of funds of Miss Nina Simone's estate. And it's alleged that her daughter used around $2 million for personal reasons. Kamala Harris's attorney general office came in and they took the estate by fining Nina Simone's daughter over $6 million in penalty fees for what she did, or what they alleged that she did. And instead of going around and working with her, instead of finding a way and saying, hey, pay restitution, she took the estate.
Michael Jackson slept in his bed at his mum's house for 30 days.
Yeah. I don't know the details of it, but you do know Jordan Chandler's come out since and said it's not true. And his dad shot himself on the back of it.
His old man committed.
Yeah. But it made this much press. Sorry, honestly, if you Google it, you'll see. Jordan Chandler has come out and said, my parents, after Michael died, my parents told me to say that to get money, and I felt ashamed of myself. And it made that much press, but his dad was so worried, killed himself.
And you look into the center, and in the center, see a glowing blue-purple light, which could be seen with the unaided eye. It looked like a star in the heavens.
Seth Putterman called it the star in a jar, a tiny spot of bright light contained in a flask of liquid. This star in a jar is made when a sound wave is passed through a small bubble inside a flask of liquid. And this sound wave makes the bubble do something remarkable. First, it expands, then it collapses. And this collapse happens so violently that vapor molecules trapped inside the bubble slam together and heat up so much that the bubble gives off an incredible burst of heat and light, several thousand times a second, giving the appearance of a star.
Hey guys, check out this incredible footage of what appears to look like some type of robotic alien android UFO jellyfish creature flying in front of a Ring doorbell camera in Miami, Florida. The lady that recorded it is a 60-year-old lady, retired school teacher, who came home from Publix supermarket after doing some grocery shopping. She said she reviewed her footage on her phone, which sent her a copy of this thing flying right in front of the camera. Now, whatever this thing is, to me, it looks like a alien, some type of gray, but a robotic version. What do you guys think this is? Also, the internet is going crazy about this video. It's all over YouTube, Facebook, TikTok, and Instagram. I've never seen anything like this in my life. I know a lot of people are going to say it's not real, but I believe it is. Check it out, guys.
It is so interesting. Why is that important to you? Why do you care if I think the supernatural is real? Like, why is that? First of all, why is it? How dare you, as my government, try to get involved in my spiritual beliefs? That's totally not your area. So get the fuck out of there, okay? A. But B, why has that been so important for 80 years for you to convince me the supernatural is not real? Why? Why is that? And of course, I can't answer the question, but my gut level response is, well, because if it is real, whatever they're telling you is not real. And if they're punishing you for saying something you know for a fact it's not real, you're not allowed to say that. Once you know that, you can sort of reverse engineer their lies and know with some certainty that whatever they're telling you is not true is in fact true. That's exactly the truth. It's exactly the truth. The obvious answer is, well, because they sort of know they're working for supernatural forces.
Actually. Or is this a hunch? Did you believe that they're working with the supernatural realm? Or have a relationship?
Well, I can't prove that. I mean, yeah. I'm suggesting that. I'm not saying it because I can't prove it, but I'm suggesting it. And if you're asking, well, maybe they're telling me the same lie for some reason. Maybe it's all part of a disinformation campaign. All the geniuses on the internet, the really smart kids, you know, think it's all you're falling for the disinformation. You know, certain claims about UAPs, UFOs. And some of them are quite vehement and sophisticated and mean, too. People who believe in this stuff aren't just wrong. They're crazy. They're conspiracy theorists.
Will not be vaccinated with anything that has not been properly vaccinated.
What the hell going on here, America?
I used to look out into the crowd, and I know you're going to think I'm lying to you. I used to look out and see faces change.
Wait.
Everything felt demonic.
Travis Scott?
Did you make it? So me and Pac still talking. Out of my fucking periphery, nigga. I can't make this up, my nigga. You know what I'm saying? I can't tell anybody this kind of shit. So I'm giving this shit to you exclusive. Check this one out. So out of my periphery, you know, you see certain shit through your periphery. So I look, and it looked like something, like the bitch was moving, like, but it looked like something else, like some horror movies. Nigga, listen. It looked real bugged out. So I looked again, bitch was regular pretty. I turned my head, I see some shit moving. I was like, so I said to myself, am I high? Because me and this nigga been smoking some good shit. I drank, I looked again, the bitch face kind of like disfigured, nigga. Now, hey. All I know is when I saw that motherfucking movie, Devil's Advocate, I was like, I seen that shit. The bitch was like that. So, nigga, it was a scene in there like that. Nigga, I went Pac, nigga. I looked again, and the bitch face was regular. I looked again. Well, and it was like the bitch was switched back. It was like she was morphing. I looked again. I said, yo, Pac, let's get the fuck out of here. He was like, what's the matter, man? He said, we're going to bring the bitch. I said, we not bringing them bitches nowhere with us.
This video is fake and scripted for entertainment purposes only. For educational purposes only. It's fictional TikTok, but if you know, you know, ooh-wee.
Hello, I teach AP and Honors Economics in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Financial well-being to me is knowing that I can be free to do the things that I love to do. I hope when I retire someday, they say, you know, that guy made this place a special place to come to school. He gave as much as he could to help the community.
Italy's invasion of Ethiopia began in late 1895 when Italian forces, armed with modern weaponry and supported by a well-equipped army, crossed into Ethiopian territory from the colony of Eritrea. Emperor Menelik II of Ethiopia, recognizing the threat, had spent years modernizing and reforming his army. He mobilized a diverse Ethiopian force, which included infantry, cavalry, and traditional warriors armed with spears and swords. The two sides clashed at the decisive Battle of Adiwa on March 1, 1896, near the town of Adiwa in northern Ethiopia. Despite being outnumbered and outgunned, Emperor Menelik's Ethiopian forces demonstrated remarkable unity and determination. They utilized effective military strategies, including a well-coordinated encirclement of the Italian troops. The Battle of Adiwa resulted in a resounding Ethiopian victory. Italian forces suffered heavy casualties, and their retreat from Ethiopia was marked by significant losses. This defeat was a major embarrassment for Italy and a significant setback to its imperial ambitions in Africa. As a result of the Treaty of Addis Ababa signed in October 1896, Italy formally recognized Ethiopia's sovereignty, and the Ethiopian Empire retained its independence. It was a rare and significant victory against European colonial powers during the Age of Imperialism, and it contributed to Ethiopia's status as a symbol of African resistance to foreign domination.
Now that I have to say this, I know we don't like to talk about it, but Mali, Ghana, and Songhai all fell because of African converts converted to Islam, sacked and destroyed their own culture and their own parents. So from the inside out. So I just need you to understand, no all Arab army came in and did anything. No European army came in. These were all Africans who were converted who came in. Even when the Europeans, under the French and stuff, they just converted Africans and made them their army to fight against the other people.
Everybody will be worshiping the false Messiah. That's what it was. That's what I'm getting hung up. The false Messiah will come and will sweep one-third of the heavens under its influence, and everybody will be worshiping the false Messiah and perceive him to be the Messiah. You've heard this before, right? Correct me if I'm wrong. Now, let's listen to this. Okay, now. Now we are in the year 2000, so now we can look at hindsight. Who rules now in the damn world? What does most motherfuckers worship? Jesus, right? So now, if the Bible is true, if we are in the end times, so you can say 1930, you say, well, you can't make that statement now because the world ain't over now. But now we can look in hindsight because we done went through our ancient history. Honorable Elijah Muhammad came, Noble True Ali came, Afrocentric community came. You even got Rabboni came. You got me. You got Daoud. You got a whole bunch of people. Motherfuckers ain't listening. They still, the mass of the people is worshiping who? Jesus. You even got, goddamn, they got new Arabs for Jesus now and Jews for Jesus.
Multi-generational trauma. One of the things that's difficult for people is their first response is, oh my God, that happened so long ago. We're talking about people being captured, shipped, sold, beaten, raped, experimented on. And then you have to ask the question, did the trauma continue? Yes, so 300 years of trauma, no help, freed. No help, more trauma. If it's a sustained trauma, then the impact of that is also sustained. When we look at multi-generational trauma, we're looking at people who are maybe victims of natural disasters and their families and their children and generations of folks who have experienced war. And we know that there are residual mental, emotional, traumatic impact. And what I did was I started to look at the African-American experience, starting with slavery, as a real clear, long-enduring trauma. So I started to see that there were clear connections between that survival behavior and contemporary living in African-American experience.
You know, the Africans been taking over, but now they got Arabs for Jesus now and Jews for Jesus now. So Jesus is dominant. Now, let me show you something here. Sometimes dominant don't necessarily mean how many people, although they got more Muslims in the world. It don't mean how many people worship, but the dominant also means what is the ruling powers into. And what is the phenomenon? Jesus is reaching more motherfucking people now. You see? So the flavor, if they say that it will sweep one half fourth of the heavens over, that can't be Horus. It can't be Satan. Because nobody don't worship Satan. Oh, you hear that shit? Did you hear that shit? It can't be Satan. Because nobody don't worship Satan. The false Messiah has got to be Jesus. Wake me up inside. I can't wake up. You understand what I'm saying? Everybody worship Jesus. Jesus don't do shit for them, but they still worship him. Now, if that ain't a damn a fucking tyrannical, brainwashing demon, I never, they say, well, you know, he deceives people. They say that the great Satan deceives people. Well, you don't worship Satan, you worship Jesus, and that's a deceiver. Think about it. Not only is this a deceiver, the world was taken over through what? Christianity. Right? Okay? And then not only did it take over Christianity, the land that it took over, they started worshiping what? Jesus. Fucking nigga in the equator, blacker than a thousand midnights, talking about Jesus. He ain't talking about no black Jesus.
No.
He talking about a cracker.
Come on.
See what I'm saying? Fucking Chinese talking about Jesus. Can you believe that shit? It's irrational for a motherfucker from Asia, Chinese man, talking about Jesus. And now I'm Eskimo talking about Jesus. That don't make no sense. But all the other people that had their own sacred deities, which was all one, nobody into that shit. So the false Messiah's got to be who? Jesus. I just proved it. If the false Messiah is supposed to be one perceived to be the Messiah, and we know based on the history, he has done what? Kill motherfuckers. That's all the shit did. What happened? Everybody died under Jesus, right? So who is the false Messiah? He gives it up right there.
Thank you. speechless. Yeah, I'm still talking, of course. Stunning! Stunning! Oh my God! Look at it! And they're telling you this is a mirage. Oh my God, I can't even... I'm sorry, guys, I apologize for having a meltdown, but this is stunning. Check this out, check this out. Towers of Kibiscan. I'm gonna zoom out real quick. And just... Well, you got to see it right there with me, pretty much at the same time. Holy shit. Okay, guys, so real quick, let me go ahead and put things a little more into perspective here. So we are on, of course, the globe model provided by Google Earth, and we zoom in to the location, and this is it right here. This is Kibiscan on the right, this is where the lighthouse is, and this is where I'm standing over here by Black Point, and standing around here. And as you can see down here, it tells you the distance between these two points, 13.75 miles. And as you can see, Cape Florida Lighthouse, according to Google, has a 95 feet tall. So for everybody who's new to this, we'll go through the Flat Earth debunking website, metabunk.org. You have a curvature calculator. At 13.75 miles away, 13.75 miles at 6 feet viewer height, the lighthouse should be hit.
So it is a one piece.
Wow.
Can you do a piece?
Yeah.
Take a video.
Oh, video is another
Take
Kodak.
A
it's another Kodak moment. So this part has to derotate underneath. Wow. So it's one piece. It's one.
So is this the aorta candle?
Yeah.
That's nice.
We're amazing.
We say like in the summertime, black folk don't act right. It's not that black folk don't act right in the summertime. It's just that black folk come to their senses when it's warm. Because if that were true, Los Angeles would always be in an uproar. What happens is when you're in a warm climate in New York City, those memories are reinvigorated. Those ideas come together. You visit your family more often. You eat the fruits that you used to eat back home. You start to think. And when people try to dominate you, you start saying, wait a minute, no. Psychologically, we go back to ourselves when we're in the climate that we left.
Keep that shit, boy! Hit that shit, boy! Hit that shit, boy! Yeah, hit that shit! Okay!
Cancer loves three things. It loves mucus, it loves yeast, and it loves acid. And caffeine is one of the most acidic things on the planet to your body. And they've got 40,000 Starbucks out there, so you wonder why it's one in two people with cancer? You're drinking yourselves this coffee all day because you're tired. But let's stop and think a minute. You're tired, so you need a brown liquid to wake you up. Why are you tired? You weren't born tired. You know, we are connected to the circadian rhythms of the universe. So when the sun comes up, our bodies are supposed to get up. And as the sun comes down, we're supposed to gradually lose our energy so that then we rest and regenerate for the next day. So if you're tired at 10 in the morning when you wake up, what's that telling me? It's telling me that your cells didn't get any food to wake you up. Your cells didn't get any fuel or nutrients to get you up. So you need a drug to make you get going for the day. But you don't really have the real energy to do it. This is a false energy. And that false energy in my world is killing you.
This girl just posted that she was shopping at Walmart at like 7 o'clock at night. And this employee came up to her and said, hey, what kind of car do you have? And she was like, a Toyota. And he said, oh, is it silver? And is this the license plate? He was on the phone with somebody and they read the license plate. And she was like, yeah. And he was like, okay, your car is getting towed. And she was like, why? And she just parked in a regular parking lot. And he said, we're starting this policy this week that we're just leaving some spots for premium members of Walmart or something. And then the guy on the phone said, it's unlocked. I'm just going to steal it. And the guy was like, he's kidding. Like, he's not going to steal it. And she was like, what is going on? And then he was like, all right, fine. We won't tow it. He was like, but you're really cute. And then started flirting with her. And she was like, what? So then this other customer stepped in and said, hey man, like she said, leave her alone. The manager comes forward and he said, that's not one of our employees. They said they've had kids come in. They have the vest with the name tag and everything.
Oh.
And they're trying to lure girls to their car. The manager ended up walking her out to her car. And he told her to take the receipt to open the door. Because they've had multiple occasions where girls reach for their handle and they pass out because there's something laced in the handle.
Jesus.
This manager's amazing. I don't know which Walmart this is. But he has an app that can detect other air tags.
Okay.
So he opens it up and her air tag came up on her keys. But then another anonymous one came up. So he said, let's search the car. And it was under her hood. They put an air tag.
Whoa.
Be careful. Don't be on your phone when you're walking around by yourself. Just be aware of your surroundings.
I struggled with my son actively avoiding me until I learned that the conversation is the connection. When I woke up in the morning, my eyes would immediately go to all the things that he didn't do the night before. The kitchen counters weren't wiped down. The clothes were not put in the laundry. There's a towel on the back of the toilet. Before my son even heard good morning, he heard me fussing about all of the stuff that he didn't do. I was aggravated because it's not like he doesn't know what's expected of him. I've said the same things over and over again, so I'm tired, right? And I used to demand that he do what I wanted him to do, and it was my way or we got a problem. And I had a habit of sneak attacking him where he would get in the car and I would be silent on the ride, and then right before we get to the school, that's when I start fussing about stuff. And then the conversation would end with something like, just get out of the car, instead of us saying bye or I love you or have a good day, or it was just silent. And I'm the one who put that distance there. When I started being truly more flexible and not circling back to previous things that he did that got on my nerves, and stayed calm and explained my thoughts and feelings to him from a place of trying to teach him and connect with him instead of ordering him around, that's what changed our relationship to where we could have candid conversations. I had to let go of my belief that children have to stay in their place and that I needed to control everything.
Secretly recording everything for 30 years. Meet Marion Stokes. In 1979, Marion began recording TV 24/7, capturing sitcoms, news, and everything in between. She was determined to preserve television history that networks were constantly erasing to save money and free up storage space. As a former librarian and activist, Marion was passionate about access to information.
Those in power are able to write their own history.
She sometimes had as many as 8 tapes spinning away at once, even getting her family in on the act. We'd be out at dinner and we'd have to rush home to swap tapes, recalled her son Michael. By the time she passed away in 2012, Marion had amassed about 71,000 tapes, the only comprehensive collection preserving this period in television media history. Now, the Internet Archive is digitizing her incredible work to make it publicly available. Marion's vision of universal access to knowledge will finally be realized, thanks to her tireless effort of